slide was an overview on the next presentation, how to make your proposal be successful. First, how to start, then information on your proposal, one slide on the resubmission rules, and then again documents and links. Getting started, how should you start, what is important? I think the important point for you is to find your future host institution. And how to find it? I think many of you are international and are already in contact with many research labs. So normally the contacts go over your research contacts. And then it's important to find the right contact inside the host institution. Nowadays, many universities have dedicated services. For example, in Switzerland, every university has a EU research regional office, and these colleagues of mine, they know very well about, for example, how to get this letter of support from the host institution, etc. So it's important to contact your national contact person very early. Many host institutions have internal deadlines, internal procedures and deadlines on how you will get the signed letter of support. For example, at EPFL in Lausanne, they do not accept every research as a future ERC grantee, ERC candidate, but only assistant at least of the level of assistant professor. So some host institutions, they have restrictions and they have specific procedures. And they can have deadlines that are long before the official deadline of the ERC. As I said, many of the host institutions, they have now services that can support you, so don't hesitate to look for them and to ask for them. Take also enough time for your proposal. Your proposal must be excellent in every aspect, starting from the layout to the content, of course, so take enough time. You will hear also about the successful proposals that were written within 2 weeks. It's fine that some are able to do that and were lucky, but perhaps it's better to really book enough time in your calendar for your proposal. The two documents that are important for you are the work program and the information for applicants, as I said before. And many NCP institutions, they provide more documents. For example, YouResearch provides a kind of annotated proposal that guides you through your proposal writing. So check what you can get from your host organization or your host country. For your proposal, you need to use the template. You can download it once the call is open. You find it on the participant portal, and entities also can provide it to you. An important point is also that you decide on your evaluation panel. Especially if you're interdisciplinary, this is not always easy. Perhaps there are two panels where you fit, and it's important to take enough time to decide, to study well the keywords of a given panel, and also the names of the panel members of the former ERC calls, to check the CVs of these persons, to check also the grantees that have a similar background as you have, in what panel that they submitted. And if you're still not sure, you may contact again your national contact point so they can try to find out together what panel could make most sense for you. Also, more information on the evaluation panels. We have the three main domains, physical engineering and physical sciences and engineering, social sciences and humanities, and life sciences. And then the 25 evaluation panels with up to 15 panel members each. The panel descriptions are can be found in the information for applicants, I think also in the work program and on the UFC website. The important point for you is that the ERC evaluation is really about science. So it's scientists who evaluate scientists. They don't mind about your nationality, about your language, about your host country. There are no quota that applies. And it's possible, for example, if the same institute at the given host institution submits three proposals to the same panel, maybe all three projects are granted. So don't be afraid if there are other colleagues of you applying with the same host institution, with the same institute, there's no problem. You might be competitors, but the evaluators, they don't check if you are from the same host institution, what nationality, what gender, etc. They want to have the best projects. And they have the ERC has some pressure. The ERC, it exists now since 10 years, and they have the pressure to find and to fund the best scientists, Nobel Prize winners of tomorrow. So they don't check who you are, what color you have, but they check if you are the tomorrow's research leader. This is what they will check. How do the evaluation panels work? So there's a certain number of proposals submitted to a given panel. And then the panel has a pre-reserved budget in that of the ERC budget going to this panel in function of the number of proposals received. So the success rate is more or less the same in every panel. And then the proposals are assigned to the different panel members in function of the of their background, of their discipline. And there are 2 to 3 panel members that read that are somehow responsible for certain number of proposals. And these are the panel members. They have read all the details of your proposals, and they will lead the discussion. After the remote evaluation, they will meet in Brussels and they will discuss all the proposals they have received inside their panel. And the 2 or 3 lead panel members of your proposal, they will lead the discussion. And then, but the important point is that all panel members have a say and they discuss really. So, normally what I have heard from the panel, from the evaluators, that they have those proposals that are clearly, that have clearly a very high quality. They are those proposals that all panel members agree that they are of a low quality. And then there are those in between. And these are the proposals where they have the most of discussion. So the first tip is now from my side. It is very important that you can convince all the panel members that your project, your concept is important. So it is important that you have a writing style that convinces specialists, but also generalists, so that everybody can understand your concept and is convinced that you are the right, your project is the right one to be funded. And this means also in terms of layout. Your proposal should have a layout that makes the evaluators easy to understand the main points. And don't underestimate this aspect. Of course, the content of your project, your research aim is the most important thing. But how you present the whole story to the evaluators should not be underestimated. I'm coming now to the proposal. This slide shows you the different parts of the proposal. So you have the part A that you complete online. You have general information such as name, etc. administrative data, contact person at your host institution, and so on. Then you have the budget. You have an ethics table that you have to fill in, even if you have no ethical aspects, and there are some call-specific questions. You have then the proposal itself, part B1, that will be evaluated only in the first evaluation step, and B2 that will be assessed both together with B1 in the second evaluation step. And then you have the annexes that you submit as PDFs. So you have this binding letter of your host institution, and there's a template. So all these letters look pretty much the same. They just have to be adapted, your host institution just has to adapt the project name, your name, and so on. Then you have to submit the PhD certificate in the case of the starting and consolidated round. If you have a prolongation of your eligibility, you have to submit also additional documents, for example, birth certificates of the children, or documents that show that you have had clinical training, etc. If you have ethical aspects, if in this table here that you filled in the A forms, if you had answered any question, you say yes, you have to provide an ethics self-assessment, which is a text that will explain how you deal with ethics. And this is an important point, so if you have ethics, take it serious. I will come to that later. As I said, part one is evaluated in the first evaluation step, and the whole proposal is evaluated in the second evaluation step, plus the interview that you will have in your panel. The important point is perhaps that panel evaluators, they have access only to B1 and B2. They don't have access to these two parts. So these two parts, they are only for the staff at the ERC executive agency. Let me give now some more information on the CV and structure code. This slide shows you the type of questions that the panel members and the remote referees, in this case the panel members for the BU of the first evaluation step, was the kind of mask that will fill in when evaluating your proposal. So they will have access to your proposal first to B1 remotely, and they will fill in the comments remotely. So for example, they would be asked about your intellectual capacity and creativity. To what extent has the PI demonstrated the ability to propose and conduct groundbreaking research? Or to what extent does the PI provide evidence of creative independent thinking? So these are questions that they will answer, and the importance that you have it. So it's certainly a good idea to have it, perhaps to print it out and have it in front of you when you write your proposal, and put yourself always in the skin of the evaluators. Your CV. There is a structure suggested in the template, but you can change it. You can choose your what kind of subtitles make sense for you. If you had career gaps, for what reason ever, because you had children or perhaps you were one in industry, whatever, mention it in your CV. In your CV, you have to fill in a table, a so-called funding idea, where you have to list all your ongoing rounds and your submitted projects. You have to be transparent on that. As I said, it's legitimate to apply to submit your project or similar one to other funding agencies, as long as you are transparent on that. And an important point, the table on these ongoing grants and applications do not count towards the page limit of 2 pages for your CV. Some information on the track record, it's again 2 pages maximally. You have to list up to five representative publications in the case of a starting round, and 10 representative publications in the case of the consolidated grant. If you are interdisciplinary or if you have special achievements, then perhaps you want to comment on a key publication. Mention the total number of publications. You have probably not enough space to list all your publications. So mention the total number of your publications and have a complete list, publication list online on your website. This is important. At the time of the project submission, check that you have an attractive website. Some information now on the extended synopsis and scientific proposal. So the synopsis is 5 pages and the scientific proposal 15 pages. Before you start writing, perhaps it's important that you have a clear idea what the ERC expects from you. So the ERC projects, they are really PI centric. So the funding goes to you as the big boss of the project plus your team members. It's clearly defined project. So your plan is a clearly defined project. And this project should be novel, creative, significantly going beyond the state of the art. Often these projects are interdisciplinary and of high risk and high gain, but feasible. And it needs to be clear that the PI is the right person to carry out this research project over the next 5 years. And it should be also clear that it is somehow going beyond national funding. Many PIs have already national funding, and the ESI project is somehow complementary to the national funding. Normally, national funding projects are not on the same level. They do not provide this long duration and this freedom to the PIs. So words on high risk and high gain and feasibility. It's important that you find a balance between being risky and feasible. You don't need to have risky projects per se. High risks are not requested per se, but it's fine if there is a high gain behind. And it's important that you demonstrate why you need this risk. It's important that it's clear, implicitly or explicitly, why you need this risk. And it's important that you have a risk analysis, so describe the risks and describe also how you tackle them. Ideally, you have not a high risk for the whole project, but for the sub-projects only. Some examples how you can demonstrate feasibility, even if you have a highly risky project. You can argue with you as a principal investigator. Perhaps you have preliminary data. Perhaps you carried out similar sub-projects before. Then perhaps you can argue with the facilities, the infrastructure you have at your host institution. Perhaps you can argue with the scientific approach or with another scientific approach that you would apply if you don't, if you are not successful. And ideally you have a good balance in the different sub-projects with risks and feasibility. This slide shows you the mask that the alert is filled in regarding the project in the synopsis. So they would write comments, answering questions, for example, to what extent does the proposed research address important challenges? To what extent are the objectives ambitious and beyond the state of the art? And in the case of the evaluation of the full proposal, then questions would go beyond, for example, to what extent are the proposed timescales and resources necessary and properly justified based on the full scientific proposal. So read this mask well, and you can find it in the work program. So go through these questions because you can understand how will they be evaluated. some words on the resources part. As I said, you have to fill in the budget twice. You have to fill it here in the A part, and you have to fill it in here in the resources part. And check that you fill in, have a final check that you really fill in the correct and same numbers. When it comes to the budget, you need to have the figures, for example, the salaries or the depreciation rate of infrastructure. You need the rules that apply to your host institution. Every host institution has their salary levels, so you check with them. You not only have to fill in a budget table, but you have also to explain the budget items. So, give a short description about the staff, about the consumables, etc. And also give a short description on your team. You don't need to provide names, of course, but for example, you would describe that you need 2 PhD students and 2 postdoctoral researchers with that and that profile. You should provide a kind of overview on the time scale. Of course, it's not possible to plan this long project in detail, but you should give an approximate planning. If during the project you will have changes, for example, you realize that you won't need a third PhD student, but you would rather need another infrastructure or so, then you can easily change these items without problems. But at the time of the project submission, you must have a rough idea how you will carry out with which time plan and which staff you will carry out the project. If you need additional budget, then you have to justify it well. Some words on the ethical issues. Ethical issues, the ethical parts will not be evaluated by the scientific, by the panel evaluators, but by a specific ethics committee. So all proposals that are on a short list or on a reserve list, they will go through an ethical screening. And once a grant is granted, the PI can only start the project if it went through all the ethical clearance, and that can take a long time. So you better prepare well the ethical documents, and you better check that you have most of the documents ready at the proposal submission. The ethical documents are not a question of eligibility. If they miss some documents, if they need information, they will contact you once your project, once you are on the short list. Then they will request your information, and it will be communication back and forth with you and your host institution and the university executive agency. But they are very strict on these questions. Yeah, I told this. There is information on the ethical parts in the information for applicants in Annex 4. And there's also guidance how to complete this ethical self-assessment that you have to submit with your proposal. And again, you are very welcome to contact your national contact point. Normally the NCPs, they are quite experienced when it comes to ethical questions. Please be aware that there are resubmission rules that apply if you're not successful with your proposal. This means that you should really check your chances in order to be able to submit again next year with a new proposal. So after the first evaluation step, you can get a grade A, which means that you are accepted for the second evaluation step. You can get a grade B, which means your proposal is of high quality, but not enough high quality to make it to the second evaluation step. or you can get grade C, which means that your proposal is not competitive enough. After the second version step, you can then get a grade A, which means you are funded if there's enough funding, or you can get a grade B, which means that your proposal is of high quality, but not enough high to get funding. So if you get a grade C in the first evaluation step, this means that you have to wait two calls till you are eligible again. If you get a B after the first evaluation step, you have to wait one call till you can submit again. If you get an A after the first evaluation step, you can submit again in the next call. And here is again a slide that you will be able to click on the link once you get the presentation. I thought to provide you again the links. So once you open this presentation, once you start to write your proposal and open these slides, then you have direct access to the document. And now I'm again ready for your questions.
Thank you very much for the good talk. One question regarding the recognition rules. Is it linked to the project or to the research? Let's admit that you have a C grade, you cannot resubmit for the two next calls, right? But is it the researcher that cannot resubmit, or if
it's the PI? It's only the PI. What I told in my slides is always about the PI.
Also restrictions, for example.
Where was I? You can only have one ERC grant at any one time, but team members working in an ERC group, they can apply for an ERC grant themselves as a PI anytime. And the same is the restriction, so this only applies to the PI. Other questions?
Regarding the submission groups, they have the designated rates of A and B and C. How many percent of submission will lead to?
The number of A's depends on the budget per panel. So the number of A's per panel is different, but the success rate to get an A is more or less the same in every panel. The number of B's and C's, there's no predefinition. So every panel decides how many B's and how many C's they would distribute. So you can be lucky to be in a generous panel or not. Yeah?
Can I ask you about panels? You said there are three big domains, and each domain have more panels, right? And or they get fun?
So
there are three big domains,
yes.
in which there are more panels, right?
Yes. We have social science and humanities. I don't know the number. Perhaps it's around six for social science and humanities, and perhaps nine and eight for life sciences and physical science and engineering.
So it's the person who apply would choose to which panel to address.
Yes. Yes.
Proposal.
Yes, it's your decision, your selection as a PI. If a panel thinks that their expertise does not fit to a given proposal, they would ask other panels, or they would even move a panel to another a project to another panel. This happens, but this is rare.
So this is why it's important to also check the components of the panels to address why the proposal.
Yes. I think it is extremely important that you check well to which panel you fit best. Every discipline has their own language, and you write your proposal in a certain language. and you want to be understood. Mm-hmm. So I think this is the main point.
About the curriculum, did they have to be strict and just upload the 2 pages, right? Because
yes.
You said they don't check if it's more than 2 pages.
Yes. More questions?
I have a question. For example, in the panels, there are also the researchers in the panel. And if, for example, in the panel is the researcher, this researcher can also apply or can be like PI?
Yes, but there are restrictions. So panel members who are 100% researchers, all panel members are 100% researchers, they can apply, but not in the years when they are active. They can only, every second year, they can apply. So it would be a conflict of interest. Actually, the ERC takes conflicts of interest very seriously. Although the panelists would not evaluate candidates who with whom they published or that are in the same office, etc. So this is quite strict. These panel members would go out of the room in, at the interview, for example, and they would not read, they would not comment on the proposals. If there is a conflict of interest. No other questions?
I have a question about the ethical issues. Is the GMOs considered an ethical issue? Like, for example, I have to modify my microorganism for my project. Does that require an ethical issue statement?
Yes, I think so. Actually, the type that you're filling is very strict, but this does not mean that it's a complicated procedure. Sometimes, for example, when you have kind of questionnaire that you distribute, it's a minor issue, and then you would just provide, or so it's what you said, you would just write a text, this ethical state self-assessment, you would write a text, and maybe it's solved very quickly, and no problem. Yeah.
Okay. Just one question. So, because here is a top researcher submitting top research project. So, can you mention some achievements that was supported this European projects?
If there are achievements.
Yes, I mean like some concrete, so we can understand and we can see exactly. Like, there was researchers who invented new medicines.
Yes, actually, the ERC, they said that they provide many success stories. When you go on the ERC website, you can find videos from successful grant winners. You can find the project success stories that you can read. Actually, also many host LCP organizations, they have success stories. For example, in research, we have many success stories as videos, as PDF documents. So you can check what kind of projects were granted and what kind of PI we have on all levels of grants, starting grant, consolidated grant, and advanced grant, not yet for the senior two grants. Moreover, you can check that there is
perhaps
you can... Yes, this is the
website. Yeah, that was the... No, it's not a website, it's just a screen capture.
Okay, yes, this is... here you can see, in terms of statistics, what the ERC achieved. We have, for example, six ERC grantees are got six Nobel Prizes in all, five Wolf medals and four Field medals. We have hotels. We have, for example, 15 countries who set up similar research, national research agency, funding agencies, such as the ERC on the European level, and so on. But actually, the ERC checks, as I said, the ERC has some kind of pressure to fund the right ones. For example, the ERC is very proud to that they have six Nobel Prize winners among their grantees who got Nobel Prize after they got the ERC grant. But of course there are also critical voices who said, but these Nobel Prize winners, they didn't get the Nobel Prize for the ERC project. they got the Nobel Prize for research that is not funded by the ERC, by other funding. So why wasn't the ERC able to fund projects that led to the Nobel Prize? So you see, there are critical voices that the ERC has a pressure to fund the right ones. So they do screen very well if they fund the right ones, and they check, for example, the kind of publications of the ERC grantees after the completion of the projects, and they were able to show, for example, that many years the US scientists were leading in the overall number of top one cited publications. And now, in the past years, researchers in Europe, they have now the higher they become, they became the leaders. They have now more top one cited publications. And the ERC was able to show that this was thanks to the ERC. So they checked to what percentage of the numbers of all the top one publications were thanks to the ERC, and they could show that the ERC made a difference. The ERC now, Europe is now more top publications than US. So the ERC is checking very well, that they are also checking where are emerging research fields. They check the science behind the project. You find all these publications on the ERC website. For example, very nice publication, Science Behind the Project. Where is the ERC able to find the emerging fields? And they could show, for example, that in the solar technology, there's new type of technology that is now emerging extremely quickly thanks to the ERC grantee. I know that because he's based at EPFL in Lausanne. So this researcher came up with new technology, and the numbers of publications on that technology increased dramatically. So the ERC was able to show that in this specific field, it is an emerging field with dramatically explosion of higher publications thanks to the ERC funded projects. So the ERC does this kind of checking, and you find all these publications on the ERC website. Does this answer your question? That's a long answer.
Yeah, excellent. Thank you.